When the lights go out, when you're stuck in a vent with nowhere to turn, when you're surrounded by death and hopelessness, things get dark. Welcome back, my fellow gamers. This is Top 10 Gaming, and I am your host, Amanda McKnight. Today, we'll be counting down the top 10 darkest moments from the FNAF franchise. So dim the lights, get all spooky fancy, and let's get counting. Number 10, the vent story. In Sister Location, we learn of the fate of someone else who crawled through the vents previous to us. And surprise, surprise, it's not good. It's not a good fate. The thing that I think makes this moment so dark is the levity that it's given in its retelling. As we crawl through the vents, it's an angsty teenage-voiced hand unit that offers to tell us a funny story. The story goes that a dead body was once found in the vent that we are in. Hand unit admits the story isn't that funny, but falls back on the fact that, hey, it was a story. As you are in the vent, the fact that there is no sympathy for the dead body or any explanation of how or when it was found just kind of adds to the darkness and the horror of this moment. Number 9, the final call. In the first FNAF game, our final call sounds like a demon picked up the phone to call you. Gone, of course, is the reassuring voice of Phone Guy, as he has his own problems to deal with after Night 4. However, that makes us wonder who exactly is calling you here, and what is it that they are trying to say? Some fans have theories on this, but no one seems to be able to fully agree on just what could be being said here, if anything. The only thing I think we can all agree on is how creepy this phone call is. And friends, before we move on to this next spot, if you are loving this list, be sure to show it by giving this video a thumbs up. And be sure to check out our FNAF playlist for even more FNAF videos. Number 8, say hi to Ballora. These mini Rinas, though, they really just get me. Why are they so creepy looking? How is this a thing when Ballora is made to look so pretty and so nice, and yet her mini Rinas literally appear as though they were just designed to be straight nightmare fuel? In Sister Location, part of our job is making sure that the animatronic performers are on their stages, practicing and ready to perform whenever they are called upon next. If they are not on the stage, we are meant to give them a controlled shock to encourage them to come out so that we can see them. For Ballora, there is one night where we do not do this, as she appears on her stage willingly. Well, not really willingly, more in pieces, which are paraded in front of us by her mini Rinas, who hold up her disassembled body. The whole moment is dark and disturbing, and makes us wonder what happened to her, and if the mini Rinas tore her apart. Of course, there is something much bigger going on when it comes to Ballora's state, in regards to the greater story in this game, but we don't know about all of that just yet, so instead, we just get creeped out. Number 7, Springtrap's fate. Or really, William's fate, I guess? In Five Nights at Freddy's 3, there is a little cutscene via the minigames that we unlock where we learn of why Springtrap looks so gnarly. You end up finding him surrounded by ghosts and see as he attempts to disguise himself in the spring lock suit, only to have those locks malfunction and have him get impaled by all the screws and parts within that suit as it all suddenly releases. These little mini games and cutscenes always have the best bits of lore, but generally also give us the most disturbing scenarios and creepy stories, all in 8-bit. What's more, I love that although Springtrap is the villain here, the ghosts actually feel really malevolent. And I know they're just like innocent little ghosts, but I'm also like, you guys kind of seem sinister here. I like it. Number 6, Step Closer. I love the Fazbear Frights books. They just add a whole lot of creepy moments to the franchise and even provide us with some of the darkest stories overall. Step Closer is the title story of the 4th Fazbear Frights book, which shares its name. In this story, we learn how Pete, the older brother of Chuck, ends up being cursed by Foxy after visiting Freddy's and attempting to tease his younger brother. Foxy's song that he sings stays with Pete, and it's believed that the curse that Foxy placed upon him through that song is causing his eye and his arm to constantly be thrust into dangerous situations. Pete figures out how to cure himself of the curse and decides to make things right, but is killed before this can happen. In the end, despite being dead, Pete is somehow seemingly still awake and within his body, and is able to witness as his hand and eye are removed, as they are needed for another patient, and Pete is listed as an organ donor. Number 5, Phone Guy's Farewell. The final phone call that you do manage to get from Phone Guy in FNAF 1 comes through on night 4. This phone call is pretty dark, as with it we are able to piece together what may have happened to our helpful friend who has been guiding us through our first week with pre-recorded messages from what we assume must have been his final week on the job. This phone call, however, seems to imply that Phone Guy never got to finish out this week, as on night 4 he was attacked by the animatronics after likely running out of power. All we can hear is his voice somewhat frantic but attempting to hold it together as he asks us to check the suits maybe in the back room for him, as he plans on hiding out there before he is interrupted by Freddy's music and what sounds like an animatronic jump scare. Number 4. Room for One More. Still one of the most horrifying and haunting stories that we have received so far from the Five Nights at Freddy's franchise comes for me, once again, from the Fazbear Frights books. The 1:35 a.m. story Room for One More is such a disturbing story that I cannot ever forget it. It really just stays with me. It recounts the tale of Stanley, a security guard who works at an underground facility, likely Circus Baby's entertainment and rental, and can't help falling asleep on the job because, well, he works nights. Minnie Arena's always come to visit him to ask if he will take them home with him, and he agrees to do so, but whenever he wakes up, they're seemingly gone. Oh well. We learn that what has really been happening is that they have been crawling into his body while he was asleep, making Stanley feel more and more unwell as the story goes on. But he doesn't realize why until the very end, when he actually witnesses one Minnie Rena crawling inside him as he screams after she asks him if he has room for one more. Number 3. Hangmen. The fate of the workers in the lore and stories is really what gets me while in the game, because you yourself as the protagonist are meant to be a worker at this place. In Sister Location, not only do we have the strangely brief and nondescriptive story of the dead body in the vent, but we also get a moment when on the last night no animatronics appear to be on their stage. Instead, Hand Unit believes they are there when we shine the light on the stages because of the presence of something much darker and awful there. That is two dead bodies which appear to be hanging from the rooftop of both of the stage areas. These bodies are likely the workers who you have been told stayed well past their shift end and have not yet left. Turns out they couldn't leave because they were too busy being dead. They're just hanging around. Number 2. Death of Crying Child. I think this was also one of the most shocking moments for me in this game, especially in FNAF 3, and especially given what happens before even this moment. Crying Child is afraid of the animatronics at Freddy's, but despite this, his brother, Foxy Bro, possibly Michael Afton, and his brother's friends take him to see the animatronics up close. Great. They are doing this obviously because they enjoy tormenting this poor kid who just wants to stay at a safe distance away, and maybe doesn't even want to be there. That whole part is a little confusing to me based on the toys that the crying child owns. It seems as though they actually might be a Freddy's fan, but maybe it's just the animatronics and not the character's overall brand that they have a problem with. They get up close and push crying child towards the animatronics, forcing him to give the animatronic a big kiss. However, crying child's head then becomes stuck inside the mouth of said animatronic and then is shown being crushed after it malfunctions. Despite the 8-bit graphics, this moment is shocking and haunting. Like I said, these 8-bit graphic scenes are just a lot. Number 1. Death of Elizabeth. A lot of the darkest moments in my mind come from one of my favorite games in the franchise, Sister Location. I mean, maybe that's part of the reason that I love it so much. I do like dark things. The death of Elizabeth is definitely one of the darkest moments out there. I especially love the eerie monologue we get from Circus Baby surrounding it, explaining how she lured Elizabeth away from the group using ice cream and was seemingly unaware of what was going on or why exactly it happened, as though it were part of Circus Baby's programming to kill Elizabeth, devouring her and trapping her soul within the animatronic. Time for an honorable mention. Another dark moment that I love actually comes from the first game and isn't so much an event that happens within the story as just a recurring game mechanic moment, if you will. Just Foxy in general in that game just creeps me out in the best possible way, whether it be him peeking out from behind the curtain or sprinting towards you or just hearing him banging on the door. Foxy has a lot of dark and terrifying moments that always startle me and threaten to linger behind in my thoughts, especially whenever I find myself staring at a closed curtain somewhere. What are some of your favorite dark moments from the games? Which moments do you think are the most disturbing that have stayed with you the longest? Let us know in the comments below. This has been Top 10 Gaming, and I'm your host Amanda McKnight, saying thank you so much for watching and reminding you to keep on gaming on. Pew pew!